Father, we thank you for this day, and we give you the prayers and the glory. We acknowledge our need of you, Lord, and we pray for your blessings in Jesus' name. Jesus loves you, died for you. Lord, we just pray that you be with us in Jesus' name. He that is unjust, he that is unjust,
mate.
Hey, mate, you're right. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still, and he which is filthy, let him be filthy still, and he that is righteous, let him be righteous still, and he that is holy, let him be holy. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Jesus Christ is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And in the last day, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
That's right.
And one day the world will end. One day the world will end. And when the world ends, the Son of God is coming back. When he comes back, he comes back with wrath, the wrath of God upon his enemies. Those who do not know the Lord will be cast in hell. Those who know the Lord will be with him forever in eternity. Jesus Christ shed his blood for you. Jesus Christ gave his life for you. He shed his blood that you may not go to the lake of fire. He shed his blood that you may not go to hell. He shed his blood. No, because Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Jesus Christ went to hell.
Jesus Christ died and rose again. And because he conquered death, he said this.
Because, my friend,
because he conquered death, he said this. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. And he was resurrected Lazarus from the dead. And because he resurrected Lazarus from the dead, he has power.
And God can be killed.
And only knowing God is through Christ. Only knowing God is through him. There is only one way to know God. Are you a Muslim, sir? Are you a Muslim?
Yes.
Yeah. What does the Quran teach about the Bible? Well, in Surah 6:34, it says in the Quran, it says, my word cannot change. That's what it says in your Quran. It says in Surah 6:34, my word cannot change. And it's in the context of prophets, plural. Now, here's the point. If God, according to you, your God, if your God said, my word cannot change, the Bible, and the Muslims say the Bible's changed, you know what that means? It means that your God changes. Because according to your word, the Bible cannot change.
As even Jesus said.
And yet you're saying the Bible can change. So your God is schizophrenic.
No,
he doesn't know what he believes. How can you say the Bible's changed? When your Quran, your Quran says it hasn't. Your Quran says it has not changed. What does the Quran say about the Bible? If you look at the Arabic, when you go and study the Quran, look at the Arabic. There is actually an Arabic word for Bible. Look at Surah 6:34.
It's in Jinn, and that's good news.
Look at
one second. It says that the Injil was given to Esau. And this was not the Bible, because the Bible was compiled. One second. Okay. The Bible was compiled after the earliest. The earliest book of Mark. How many years after Jesus did it come? It came. It came 40 years minimum after Jesus.
Don't argue with us.
So when online the Quran says the Injil that was given to Jesus, it could not be referred.
Okay.
To the Bible.
Okay. Let my friend. Bear
did
with
you
me.
Understand
I understand. I listen to what you say, right? Even if I grant you your argument, you're still believing. Let me just finish. You're still believing, even if I grant you all that, you're still believing that God gave the Injil and Torah, right?
Yeah.
And you're saying that it got corrupted. Now here's the point. Now listen. What you're saying is, number one, God can be defeated. Number two, that God can change. And number three, your Quran is not telling the truth. So whichever way you look at it, whichever way you look at it, whichever way you look at it, let me just finish. Whichever way you look at it, any attack that you put against me, any, let me just finish. Any criticism of my Bible that you give me proves my Bible and actually contradicts you. Because your Quran says my Bible's not changed. And if you say it's changed, it means your God can change.
Okay, Allah in the Quran, you said the Quran does not say that the Bible is changed. What does Allah say in the Quran? Woe to those who change the book with their own hands. Who is this referring to?
What does the Bible also say?
What is it also saying?
What's the Arabic for change? What's the word Arabic?
You don't know Arabic, so it's
what
no
is
point.
It? What you is don't the know. Word? What's the word?
You know when you spoke? I didn't understand. Okay, so the Quran says the Bible has been changed. This is nonsense. And the Bible in itself, it says, woe to the scribes who change the book with their own hands, saying this is from God, but they have falsified. This is the Bible. Paul says, if by my lie the truth is abounded, why do you then judge me as a sinner? Shows that Paul himself is lying for the truth to come out. This is not what I've finished. So when you say, the point was that the Quran does say that the Bible has been changed, and the Quran does not say that the Bible is the one that was given to Jesus. It says the Injil was given to Jesus. One second, you said 2 minutes.
And you believe that Quran has not changed?
You said 2 minutes. In regards to the Bible, we do not know who wrote it. We do not know when it was written. So why should we have any belief in it?
Okay, right. Number one, when you say about the Quran, in Surah 634, it says, my word cannot change. It's in the context of prophets, plural. So that debunks what you're saying, right? What you've got there is contradiction within the Quran. Let me just finish. Surah 634 says, my word cannot change. It's in the context of prophets. The Arabic word, let me finish. The Arabic word for change that you're going into, you've read there, is about change as in interpretation. They were manipulating the interpretation, not changing the text, right? Now, about knowing the Bible, right? There are Clement, Ignatius, and Irenaeus. Irenaeus said that there are four corners of the world, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That was 200 AD. We have tons of traditional information that tells us who wrote the Gospels, for example. We have documents in Chester Beatty Library where we have tons of Paul's epistles that come from the second century. No scholar in the world today will argue, for example, that Galatians was not written by Paul. They might argue one or two others, but we know Paul's epistles generally, and we know the New Testament. Okay. Let me just finish. I'm going to preach in a minute. Here's the point. If the Quran says the Bible's not changed, and he says it's changed, then that means God changes. Any attack he puts upon my Bible, it contradicts him. Any attack upon me, it reaffirms my position. Right? Okay, I'm just going to tell you about Jesus. Jesus loves
you. You have to give me your comeback.
See, this guy is good at debating.
No,
are you Christian?
No.
Have a chat with him. He's a PhD student.
One question.
I'm going to preach.
Just
now.
One question.
Have a chat with this guy. He'll give you all the information.
Who's the author of Hebrews?
He'll give you the information. This guy's a PhD.
Hebrews is an unknown author.
He wants to preach. He doesn't
have a chat with him.
He wants to I'm going to preach.
Jesus Christ shed his blood. He gave his life for you. He died on the cross. Now, listen. Have you ever lied?
Yeah,
the Bible says thou shalt not lie. Have you ever lied?
Lie.
He said he lied.
Have you ever said a lie?
Yeah.
What does that make you?
Bad.
Yeah. Now, instead of God punishing you for your lies and sending you to hell, Jesus said this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son.
So all you're asking
I'll let you talk.
I promise you, I'll let you talk when I finish this verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes on me shall not perish, whatever the masculine life. Listen, let me finish. Jesus, my friend, loved you so much that when he was shedding his blood on that cross, he was, let me finish, he was dying for your life. Go on. I said I'd let you talk.
Jesus said, I'm going to die for you, son, and I'm dying
for you, son.
Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. He said, Mark, Jesus said,
he's going against the verse where Jesus said, the Father's son is not born on the son, and the son is not born.
Mark chapter 10.
Everyone's accountable.
Mark chapter 10. My friend, let me friend, you
tell
said,
people what Jesus
you said, where does Jesus say
you
died?
You are,
Mark
wrong.
Chapter 10, read it.
Wrong.
He says, I
you
give my life for
all religion, not for one new religion. Of course, someone is for religion.
You want to talk to him?
You believe for every religion.
He shed his blood for you on that cross. He loved you. Let me tell you a story. Let me tell you a story. There was this guy, he was a multimillionaire. He had a son who he loved. And his son died in the First World War. Yeah. But he had a picture made of his son. And it wasn't brilliant. It was really, really scruffy. Really, really scruffy. Listen. Now, everybody came. When his son died, when the millionaire died, all the family came, and they were all greedy and selfish. And they were all hoping they were going to get all the millions. But the solicitor said, before we read out the will, we're having an auction. And whoever buys this, will someone buy this picture of this boy? Nobody would buy it. It was a scruffy picture. But the janitor, who was cleaner of the toilets, said, I'll buy it. And he bought it for like £10. And then the solicitor said, this is what the millionaire has said. Whoever's bought the picture of my son gets all my millions. You know why? Because his son was so precious to him. And that janitor valued his son. Now, you can have everything, but if you miss the son, Jesus Christ, you've missed it all. You see, he's the one that loved you and died for you. Listen, you can, listen.
What did he
you
say
can,
when he
listen,
died?
You can accumulate philosophy, you can accumulate money, power, sex, but if you miss the son, Jesus, you missed it all. He loved you.
Did Jesus
he died
have a God? My question
he shed you,
did Jesus
shed his
God?
Blood for you, and gave his life.
Just a quick question. Did Jesus have a God?
Did Jesus have a God?
Yeah.
Well, in the Quran...
No, according to the Bible, you don't believe the Quran, so let's not...
I'm going to answer for the
Quran.
He doesn't believe it. You believe in the Quran, but he doesn't believe it.
Are you a dictator? Are you a dictator?
According to the Bible, my question is...
Are you a dictator?
Jesus.
Well, let me answer it the way I want to answer it. You can't dictate to the answer, yeah? Yeah? In the Quran, it says, let me finish. In the Quran, it says that Jesus is the Word of God.
Right?
Now listen. In the Bible, it says this. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So right at the beginning, the Word was always there. And in your Quran, it says he's the Word. Now, is the Word God? Does the Word of God have the attributes of God?
It has the attributes of God.
Yeah. So Jesus is the Word from the Quran, means he's God. God bless you. Check my hand, Muslim. We're friends.
We're friends.
Come on, bro. We're friends.
Shake your hand. You haven't answered the question. Why don't you quote the verse that says, I'll go to my God and your God?
All right, I'll do that.
You believe Jesus died for your sins?
Yes.
Oh, saints, be speaking about God. If you were at the crucifixion of Jesus,
yes.
Would you say, let me ask a question I've always wanted to ask. Would you say that the enemies of Jesus crucified him?
Yes.
You sure about that?
Yeah. But the Jews and Pontius Pilate, yeah.
And Pontius Pilate didn't want to have anything to do with
it. But it was in the plan of God. Plan of God, yeah.
Good. My question to you, if you were at the crucifixion, at the Mount Calvary where you were crucifying Jesus, and these wicked Romans are crucifying him, what would you have done?
What would I have done?
I'm not a hypothetical person, but...
What would I have done?
Yes,
if I saw Jesus being crucified,
yes, yeah,
well, some of his disciples run away. Yeah. What I would have done, I don't know if I would have known he's the Messiah or not, because I might have walked in sin and ignored him and rebelled against him. Right? But if you read Isaiah 53, let me just finish. The Jews are told not to read Isaiah 53. If they read Isaiah 53, they say it's Israel. Now, does this sound like Israel? This is written 400 years before Jesus. The Jews are told not to read it. If they read it, it's Israel. Let me just finish. Does this sound like Israel? He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. By his stripes we are healed. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Is that Israel, or is that a prophecy 400 years before Jesus that the Messiah would come and die for us?
We come back to Isaiah, the book of Isaiah, and Daniel and all that. But you're not answering my question. If you were there, or people who were there who believed in Jesus, is going to die for their sins, what would they have done when they were seeing Jesus crucified?
Well, the Jews who had the scripture, right? Let me explain. The Jews had the scripture, and they went and killed him.
They killed him.
Do you know why? Because it says the heart is deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Unless God opens your eyes, you see, you look at the world with your glasses on, yeah? And you see the color from that glasses, yeah? The world looks at God with glasses, dark glasses. They don't see God. They don't see the light. What God has to do, let me finish. If I take those glasses off, you can see the sun properly. God opens your eyes and makes you born again by the Spirit. And when you become spiritual and have a spiritual heart, and God makes you born again by the Holy Spirit, you begin to see the truth. Yeah? So I can answer all your questions.
But you're not answering the question I asked you.
Well, that's what people always say. But my friend,
well, why don't you
listen, I've got a degree. I've got a degree from Manchester University.
In plain, simple
in theology,
English.
Right?
I'll put it in plain, simple English. If you were there, would you have been supporting the crucifixion of Jesus? Yes or no?
No, listen, no. You're saying yes or no. You're making me answer one way or the other. That's a debate tactic, yeah? Listen, yes it is. Listen. I don't deal in hypotheticals. I have to have something concrete, the Word of God. The Word of God prophesied the Messiah would die. Now let me ask you something. Are you a Muslim?
I am not a Muslim.
Are you? What's your position? Are you an atheist?
Yes, I am an atheist.
You're an atheist. Okay, if you're an atheist, how do you know that this reality is real if you're an atheist?
I don't want to go in any philosophical discussion with you. I was want you to answer the question I asked you.
So
what would you
so
have
you
done?
So you want me would to you answer questions, but you will answer questions.
Because you're claiming the God to be true.
All right.
You have to answer the question, you, sir.
Is this
real? Claiming no, no, as any God.
I know why you're looking for a rat hole.
No.
Because you would have found yours. Let me tell you.
Let me finish.
Let me tell you first.
The atheist won't answer the question why. Because as an atheist, you don't know if reality is real. Your brain could be being manipulated by demons. It could be being manipulated by aliens.
You
just don't know
as
an atheist. You just don't know.
Yes.
But we know we're not being manipulated. It's called a philosophical concept called the impossibility to the contrary. Without the idea that there is a God, you couldn't know anything. Because God assures you that your senses are in connection with reality and reality is real. Without that idea, an atheist doesn't know if a supercomputer across the universe is manipulating his brain. That's why he won't answer the question. Let me ask you another question. Let me ask you another question.
No, answer my question.
His logic.
No, let me tell you why.
Jesus loved you and died for you. I'm happy to debate. I've debated thousands of atheists.
You're not answering my question.
Logic. Answer the question. Answer the question. Is logic material or immaterial?
Don't ask me these kind of questions that you're confusing yourself. Just answer my question.
The atheist won't answer a simple question. Is logic material or immaterial?
Do you know what is logic?
I'm talking about the law of no contradiction. A is not B in the same context.
My question to you, and I want you to answer it.
I love you, bro. I love
you. I know
God bless you. God bless you. You don't want to engage. Never mind. Don't worry. Don't worry. You want me? You want me to answer your question?
Let me tell you why you're not.
You want me to answer? Let me tell you another story. Let me tell you a story. I'll tell you a story and I'll answer the question that you give me.
Tell me about.
Here's the story, yeah?
About a cock and a bull.
This girl, she became a prostitute. Let me finish this story. She became a prostitute. Yeah? She lived in Puerto Rico. She became a prostitute. Her mom was brokenhearted and went to find her, couldn't find her, right? So she put pictures of herself all in the hotels and toilets. She came home. She came home, brokenhearted. I can't find my daughter. She's a prostitute. One day, her daughter was with a client because she was a prostitute. She came down the stairs and she went into the toilet of the hotel and she saw a picture of her mum. That's my mum. She picked the picture up and she turned it around and there was some handwriting of her mum's. And the handwriting said this: I don't care what you have done, come home. Don't care what you have done, come home. The prodigal son went back to his father, and the father in the Bible put his arm around it, put a ring on his finger. He said, my son was lost, but now he's found. The Lord says that to you today. He says, come home. I don't care what you've done. He knows you've messed up. We all mess up. I've messed up. We all fail. We're not perfect. But he wants you to come home. He wants you to come home and know that forgiveness. There is a love, let me finish, there is a love so vast, so deep, that you could never understand it. And it's the love of Jesus. Christ shed his blood for you so that you could come home. But if you continue to lie, steal, have sex, take drugs, worship idols, your Facebook, your Instagram, your car, your pension, your money, if you worship that, then you're worshipping an idol, and it'll send you to hell under the wrath of God. The hell will come and gnaw you, and you'll be in hell and you'll be crying and you'll be saying, Jay, I want to get out of hell, and you won't be able to get out. But today is your day. Will you repent, sir, and believe in Jesus? Will you repent and believe in Jesus? Will you trust him? Will you come and trust him? Will you find his love?
Wanted Jesus dead just as his enemies wanted
him. And I just want to say, sir, you won't kill with them.
You would have no
love. You come and know his love. And know his show his blood.
Can you read, please? For God's sake, please read 23 Ezekiel 20.
Ezekiel 23.
20. Yeah. Read us and explain to us, because I'm very sincere knowing.
Do you know when it was written, Ezekiel?
Well, I don't know. You're the one Bible expert. You indicate us.
What's the book of Ezekiel about?
What's the book? I'm asking you to read the verse.
What's the book of Ezekiel about? What's the book of Ezekiel about?
I don't know.
What are the last chapters of Ezekiel? The last chapter is about
a
temple.
My question with a question.
Do you know why? Yeah, you know why? Because it's not a sincere. It's not a sincere question. No, you've been googling. You've been googling because you want to try and trip me up. But you've never read the book. You don't even know who wrote it. You don't know any book. You don't know anything about it.
Yeah. It's a red herring. You're avoiding the question.
No, because what he's trying to do, he's trying to entrap me because he's been googling there and trying to find a verse or whatever. All right.
And you believe in the Bible?
I believe in the Bible, sir. Okay, I'm a preacher.
You should be confident to read that verse.
I am confident of it. But you're not honest and sincere.
You're presenting as if you're honest and sincere.
You're not.
Yeah, but how do you know that?
Does he want to really know the answer? Has he been Googling to try and trap me?
Can I ask a question with the woman caught in adultery and they're trying to check the law?
No, you're not sincere.
How do you know?
If you've got a sincere question, I'll answer that question. Jesus Christ shed his blood and he loved you. There's a hymn. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus. Vast, unmeasured, boundless, free. Rolling as a mighty ocean in its fullness over me. A mighty love for you. A great love. A mighty love. Did you know in the Quran? What does it say in the Quran about sex? It says, plow your wife.
Exactly.
Is that a good thing about?
It's not a good thing.
Not a good thing, no. But Jesus showed love. He showed you love. He showed you that love where he died on that cross and he shed his blood for you. Come to him before you go to hell. Is that in the New Testament or Old Testament? Jesus said, I have come to fulfill. Let me finish. Jesus came to fulfill the law, and instead of going to war, he took the judgment for you. So when he died, let me finish. When he died on that cross and shed his blood for you, let me finish. When he shed his blood for you, he took your wrath, right? So it's the new covenant. The new covenant is a covenant of his love and mercy displayed in the love of Jesus and shed his blood. Here's a question. In the Quran, it says he didn't die on the cross. Yes. Do you believe that?
I believe that. Shall I tell you why? Because according to Luke, only a false Messiah would die outside of Jerusalem. Where did Jesus die? Outside of Jerusalem. So according to Luke, Jesus is a false Messiah. Because in the first book of Hebrew, I do believe, it said that Jesus died outside of the gates of Jerusalem. So explain that. Okay. According to the Old Testament, okay. Jesus is a false Messiah.
Well, I believe it's
I'd rather stick with okay. I'd rather stick with the Quran, which claims Jesus to be a true Messiah. Than a false
okay. Okay. You're not. I can see this guy's. I can see in your face that you're an honest, normal guy who likes an honest debate. Yeah. So. You will admit, before I get to my point, you will admit the Quran says he did not die.
I don't know where it is in the Quran, but I know the Islamic opinion is that he didn't die.
Right. Yeah, so you agree?
Or somebody died instead of
him. Okay. So forget about the Quran, forget about the Bible, right? Because I'm prejudiced. I'm biased, my Bible, I'm biased with my Bible. And you're biased with your Quran, yeah? So put Bible side, put Quran side. Josephus, around about 80, 90 AD, said that Jesus was crucified under Pontius Pilate. Josephus was an enemy of Jesus. Josephus was a Pharisee. He hated the Christians, yeah? Right. Tacitus, a Roman historian, 90 AD, said Jesus died under Pontius Pilate. Now, who are you going to believe? The Quran that came 600... Let me finish. The Quran that came 600 years after Jesus. Yeah, I like you, mate. You're a nice guy. He came 600 years after Jesus, right? The Quran says he didn't die, and it's not based on eyewitnesses, right? The Gospels are based on eyewitnesses. Listen, says he died, but without the Gospels, we have enemy attestation, Josephus and Tacitus. Who are you going to believe? Josephus and Tacitus, enemies of Jesus, who said he died under Pontius Pilate, or Muhammad, who never met Jesus 600 years later? What?
In Islam, we do believe that someone did die. We believe that someone took the shape of Jesus with the permission of God and died for Jesus. So any eyewitness testimony does not go against the Quranic disposition or the Islamic disposition, because we believe that someone did die on the cross. So what was the other point? Sorry.
Well, right. You're a very noble. You're a very noble guy, but I'm going to give you a lesson in history. Yeah.
I want to give you a lesson on the Gospels, please.
Okay.
We'll get to that.
Yeah. Okay. Right. You're admitting that the Quran says somebody died, right?
Yeah.
It says it in the Quran. Yeah. Yeah. Let me finish. What I did, I didn't use my Bible. I used historical sources outside the Bible, which most historians, 90% of historians, would agree. Right? Yeah. Now he says that somebody died. We say specifically Jesus. Josephus says specifically Jesus. Tacitus says specifically Jesus. We have evidence outside the Bible that I am answering. Nice to see you. We have evidence outside the Bible, Josephus and Tacitus, that said Jesus died. You do not have any historical evidence outside the Quran to substantiate this person. You don't even know the name of the person who is supposed to have died. Over to you. Do you want to come in, Mansour?
First, your evidence that there are historical evidence outside the Bible, they're very late. Okay. Josephus and Tacitus, the earliest manuscripts of them we have is very, very late. The earliest manuscripts of Josephus is from like 10th century. 10th century, like 1,000 years later. So are you saying these, whatever Josephus said, and the extant documentary evidence, almost 900 to 1,000 years later, is pure and intact? So the evidence you're giving is very post-Islamic. Secondly, Josephus, was he an eyewitness? Of course he wasn't. Tacitus, was he an eyewitness? Of course he wasn't. So he's getting information from somewhere. What we say is, it's a rumor. Yes, the crucifixion of Christ is a very well-attested rumor in history. But that's all it is. It's a rumor. We have evidence to the contrary. There are other people who believe that it was Simon the Cyrene who was crucified, or it was someone else who was crucified. The evidence to the contrary, not from Islam, from extra biblical sources within the period before Islam. So we have people who believe it wasn't Christ who was crucified, it was someone else in his stead. So even within Christianity, overall teaching of Christianity, there are groups of people that didn't believe that Christ was crucified, it was someone else. What we are merely saying is, the Quran does not deny that there was a crucifixion. It says it appeared to them. So,
meaning people mistakenly thought that Christ was crucified, but it wasn't Christ who was crucified.
Can I come in? Listen to you with respect. Can I just say, it's good to see you, bro. I'm sorry for the clash that we had last time, but I'm going to listen to you with more respect this time.
So what do you have to say about
that? So first of all, you're on about it came like a 1,000 years or 900 years after, yeah. A couple of things. Dominic Crossan, who is a world authority on historical Jesus studies, who is against my position, says that Jesus dying on the cross is one of the most well-attested... I'll get to the evidence in a minute. He said that Jesus dying on the cross is one of the most well-attested facts in ancient history. Bart Ehrman, who's against my position, who Muslims use to attack Christianity, says that Jesus dying on the cross is a well-attested fact of ancient history.
Right. Let me just finish.
Ancient history. In person.
Ancient history, yeah. Right? So
your Dawah will send you.